Fantastic.
Liz Goody, you're going to love it. Tell me to watch.
Is it better than you thought?
It is so much better.
What a lovely surprise.
I mean, no disrespect to anybody involved, but I mean, that was really good.
Let's work our way through the characters. We saw there it's Thomas Spence. He's a working dad. He's in a sort of father who relies on his bonuses and his pitches.
Yeah.
And he's making a pitch, and it just gets too much.
It's a do or die moment for him, really. Yeah. Ken Rose, who plays this guy, Thomas. Yeah. They're pitching for a piece of business. He goes to pieces, and then Susannah and the rest of the team, you start to sort of turn on him slowly, and it's bullying. But it's so clever because it's really deniable bullying. It's not the sort of thing you can ever prove. So they do kind of things like, you know, they
making post-it notes all over his desk, and it sort of could be a joke, and you start to wonder whether maybe it is all in his head, and maybe they are just having a laugh, and it's that really, really thin line between, you know, what's stepping them up over.
Yeah.
But it feels like a thriller. That's the thing. Yeah. It feels like you think, is he going to stand up to these people or not?
Yeah.
And then, if he does stand up to them, then you sort of start to wonder, should you be standing up to them? Should you meet bullying with what's essentially bullying itself, you know?
So your character, because you play Carter, and he's head of sales. Now, you sort of say he's great on a night out, maybe not the person you want by your side if you're going through
He's a little bit unreconstructed. Do you know what I mean? He's a little bit of a dinosaur, Carter. So, you know, his attitude is, you know, I was never bullied. What's the matter with yourself? You know, pull yourself together. We're not in the schoolyard. Mm. You know, this is work. And you're going to have banter and you're going to need to give as good as you get. It's all part of building a team. This
so
is how we work.
So sort of it's all bants, but without realising how that
lands. He doesn't really realise, because it's very, very hard to pick up on. And as far as he's concerned, he starts to wonder whether Thomas is really in his right mind. You know, that's, you know, maybe the pressure's getting to him, you know.
Well, Isabel is very straight-minded. She's a powerful woman.
Yeah.
She knows what she wants.
Very ambitious.
Very ambitious. Yeah. And you would think that she appears to be his ally.
That's right, yeah, she does. And at this point, he really needs a friend. And so she's sort of tries to take him under her wing and help him get off this path, which is leading in not a very good direction. Mm. He's getting more and more overwhelmed and more anxious and making mistakes. So there's lots of scenes where you feel like Isabel's really helping him, but in Thomas's mind, he then starts to wonder whether even that's real.
Yeah.
So
right, I see.
His whole reality is kind of is shifting out at all times. So the tension is kind of, it's hard to watch.
I mean, even just watching that promo there, you can feel the intensity of it.
Yeah.
Did it feel like that filming it?
Well, actually, it was sort of the opposite, filming it, because the show's about bullying, everyone was going out of their way to be as nice as possible. So it was like, would you like to come downstairs and we're just going to do a couple of scenes? Normally, sort of get down there as quickly as you can, because we're about 10 minutes behind.
Absolutely. So it was all everyone. No one was ever left out. Never a sense of someone not being invited to
because
have
here's a really funny
with
thing.
Us.
With a show like with a story like this, it really makes you think about the way you deal with people at work. Mm. You know, when I'm asking somebody to do something, am I asking them in a way that's respectful? Am I asking them in a way that is maybe verging on, you know, abusing my power?
Sure.
Yeah.
So this is, you know, and we're all having these debates at the moment, aren't we, about how we want to be with each other, questioning all kinds of authority, you know,
political authority. Well, drama's very good at doing that, isn't it?
Yeah.
Sort of raising those questions.
Yeah.
It's also written by Mike Bartlett, who wrote Dr. Foster. So there is a huge level of expectation on this because that was so successful.
Yeah.
Do you feel that? Is it, you know, when you take on something like this?
Yeah, you do. I mean, I was a huge fan of Dr. Foster.
Yeah.
I thought that was such an unusual drama. You know, those sort of intense thriller dramas often tend to be police dramas, but a bit like Dr. Foster, this is one where people can relate to it, I think. Everyone at some point in their life's been in the workplace or been part of some sort of
bullying, dynamic,
I think, or some sort of dynamic like this. So there is a pressure, but I feel like it's a super relevant show, isn't it?
You made that almost like the dream trip from the stalls to the stage.
That's right.
What were you doing initially?
So I was selling ice creams and taking tickets at the National Theatre. That was my job when I was at drama school, and I used to come in early every night and watch the actors warming up on stage, thinking one day maybe that will be me. And I was just in the right place at the right time. And
well, with a huge load of talent.
Well, hopefully a sprinkling of that. But yeah, I was then ended up on the Olivier stage 6 months later, playing opposite Zoe Wanamaker in a Tennessee Williams play.
Oh,
so
my God.
Sometimes, you know, life deals you...
Well, you're standing there on the stage and looking back to where you were.
Waving.
Yeah.
Wow. And you, I just want to ask you about this next Netflix period drama thing, which has been described as Jane Austen meets Gossip Girl, at which point my mind just went, oh, this is everything.
It's fantastic. Yeah, Shonda Rhimes, who... my mind's gone blank. That fantastic Grey's Anatomy, amazing show that she does in the US, is doing her first big show for Netflix, and it's all set in 1813, Regency London, basically about young people coming onto the London scene and having to get married within the season. So it's sort of very high pressure, but getting up to all sorts of...
I bet. We've got to wait a really long time for that. Are you filming at the moment, or is you...
Yeah, we're filming at the moment. I think we finished in the spring, so it might be on by the autumn, kind of thing. Yeah.
I know. We know that you wrote a book for Jackson.
Yes.
And so
Nighttime at Father Christmas.
So The Boy Who Made the World Disappear.
So I'm writing a story for each of my children, basically. Yeah. And this year I'm doing one for Harrison, my middle child. And it's about a boy. Harrison has a little bit of a temper, because then anything that makes him cross, he can put it in the black hole and just get rid of
it.
So for the first time in his life, he has power, and he gets it. In goes broccoli, his homework, the school bully, and then eventually he puts his parents in there, then has to try and get them out again.
That's a great idea.
Lana, my daughter, I'm writing hers at the moment, and then I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to run out of children.
Can you write one for me?
I'll write one for you guys.
Thank
you very much.
Yeah, it's lovely to see you. Sticks and Stones is what we're talking about. Monday, the 16th of December, obviously, at 9 p.m. on ITV, and it's 3 parts.
Yeah, it's on over 3 nights. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Yeah, the tension builds.
Can't wait. Thank you.
Thank you.